Welcome to How Brands Are Built, where branding professionals get into the details of what they do and how they do it. I'm your host, Rob Meyerson. Thanks for listening. This episode is brought to you by Squad Help, the world's number one naming platform. To use Squad Help and launch a naming contest today, go to squadhelp.com and start receiving custom name suggestions instantly. He's been called the father of modern branding. If you've ever read anything about branding or brand strategy, my guest today requires no introduction. I'm talking to David Ocker, author of over a dozen books and hundreds of articles about marketing and branding, professor emeritus at the Haas School of Business, UC Berkeley, and vice chair at Profit, a global marketing and branding consultancy. Given this season is about positioning and brand platforms, I couldn't pass up the opportunity to ask David directly about his brand vision model, which most people refer to simply as the Ocker model. We also talked about two of his most recent books, Ocker on Branding, 20 Principles That Drive Success, and Creating Signature Stories. Without further ado, here's my conversation with David Ocker. David Ocker, thank you so much for joining me.
Glad to be here.
Let's talk about one of your most recent books, Ocker on Branding, 20 Principles That Drive Success. For those who haven't read it, Ocker on Branding, it seems like it's a summary of the most useful branding concepts out there, including the ones that you've introduced throughout your eight previous books. But what motivated you to write that book, and why was this the right time to write that book?
Well, I had written about eight books that are on branding or related to branding, 2,300 pages. And just for the people at Profit, the firm I'm connected with, they would ask me, what book should I read or what books? And I would say, well, read these 40 pages in this book and read these 80 pages in these books. And it was kind of brutal. So I needed to have a place to go for people that asked me, you know, I'm not going to read eight books. What should I read? So I wrote a book to sort of capsulize the main ideas that were in each of those books. So it's sort of a 180 pages kind of Reader's Digest version. And it was really kind of nice for me, too, to figure out what really was important and how do you package that into. So there was maybe 800 ideas and examples and so on, and it's positioned into 20 principles. And within those 20 principles, there's sort of five major headings that it's in. And so you can really access my material a lot better.
And well, I know one of the kind of big concepts that you've introduced to the world of branding is the brand vision model. So I do want to spend a little time talking about that. But maybe before we do that, you mentioned that there are several other concepts that you've introduced and that are covered in this book. So I'd love it if you could just go through those four kind of big ideas and give us a little bit of a sense of what those are.
Well, one was sort of buried in a 450-page book called Brand Relevance. And I'm going to redo that book and make it sharper and bring in some more digital experiences in the next couple of years. But the idea is that we need to move from brand competition to subcategory competition if you want to grow. If you look at category after category and you see spurts of growth, they're almost always caused by somebody that's invented some kind of a must-have, changes what people buy, created a new subcategory, and then managed that subcategory to grow. And so you have things like the Prius and the minivan that Chrysler came out, both of which lasted 16 years with no competition. No competition. Chrysler made 12 million vehicles with no competition until finally Honda and Toyota came out with a competitor. And that's the way to grow. And my brand versus is better than your brand competition is not only not fun, but it almost never results in real growth. So that makes a change in business strategy. You have to put a little bigger bet on big innovations instead of marginal innovations. And we have to recognize opportunities when they emerge because they don't emerge every day.
And is creating a new subcategory, how much of that is really about innovation versus being able to tell a good story about this, you know, claiming that this is a new subcategory, even if maybe the innovation isn't quite there? Is it just striking a balance between those two things?
Well, in most cases, it's not sort of technological innovation where something new came along. even in the technology thing, if you look at all of Apple's, Apple's done it 7 or 8 times. But if you look at each of those innovations, they really packaged emerging technology. They didn't invent anything. Mm-hmm. And that was true with the iPod. It was true with the iPad. It was true with the iPhone and so on. They just packaged emerging. They were on top of technology, and they packaged emerging innovation. You know, Uber and Airbnb, they didn't really have to invent much. I mean, they had some software challenges, but they basically were able to marshal what was available to address an opportunity.
Let's get back to those big concepts that you've introduced. So I think we've got the brand vision model now and the idea of competing as a subcategory instead of on the brand level.
Well, one is the whole idea of portfolio strategy and the idea that a brand is not an isolate, you know, on an island. It's within a family of brands. And so you have to make those family work so they generate synergy and they generate clarity and they generate, you know, relevance. And it's a big challenge. And the problem with portfolio strategy, it's very messy. And it's really tied to the business strategy, which is often ill-defined or dynamic. Mm-hmm. And so it's very difficult as opposed to some of the other challenges we face in branding. Therefore, what we have to do is to bring a half dozen or a dozen tools and concepts to the party and use them when it's applicable to solve a particular problem. Like one typical portfolio problem is how do you brand a new product? Do you use an existing master brand or do you use a sub brand or do you use an endorsed brand or do you use a new brand? And so we have some theories along those lines to help you. But there's no rules of thumb.
Yeah, that's one of those challenges that when brands do it right, it seems like it was an obvious choice. But when you're actually on the inside trying to make that decision, all of a sudden it feels like any of those options could make sense. And it's really hard to figure out what's best.
Yeah. And there's one more thing I'll throw out, and that is the idea that customers basically aren't interested in your firm, they're not interested in your brand, they're not interested in your product attributes, you know, tragic though that is. What they are interested in is what they're interested in. So what you need to do these days is two things. One is you need to develop some kind of a shared interest program where you get involved in what they're interested in, and then you become a partner, an active partner, like Sephora did with what they called Beauty Talk, and they now call Sephora Insider, where they have a community of people that are interested in beauty, and they get over 1 million, people participating each month in that. And the second thing you need to do is you tell stories instead of presenting facts or product attributes or program descriptions. You have to tell stories, narratives. So that's something that I think fundamentally it needs to be understood by people trying to communicate in this digital age.
And that, I assume, is why you've written your most recent book, Creating Signature Stories, which I definitely want to ask you some questions about as well.
Yeah, for sure.
So since this season of this podcast is really all about brand positioning, I'd love to focus for a little bit on that brand vision model. And of the 20 principles in the Acher on Branding book, about 7 of them, or I think exactly 7 of them, are really related to what you call brand vision. So the first question is really around terminology. What is a brand vision, and how is it different from some of these other terms that are floating out there, like brand position, brand promise, brand purpose, and so on?
You know, I called it the brand identity model initially, and I did that because I just wanted to communicate the fact it's such a fundamental concept to a brand. But there's some problems with identity, so I changed that in the last book to brand vision. But a lot of people, as we discussed offline, that a lot of the people, call it brand positioning. In fact, the company I'm with, Profit, calls it brand positioning.
Okay.
Because that's what people are used to and that's familiar with. So there's a lot of things you can call it. And some people talk about brand values and they kind of mean the same thing. So actually, the terminology is not so important. What is important, I think, are these some fundamental ideas. And for me, the reason I started in branding in the late 80s and wrote my first book, Managing Brand Equity, which tried to define what brand equity was. And in that book, I talk about the dimensions of brand equity. And then in the next book, Building Strong Brands, Developed a Brand Identity Model, I really was I had three or four premises that I began with. I was just so convinced that the agency model of running bands was wrong. Mm-hmm. And that was you develop a three-word phrase, a single thought, a single concept, and then you develop a campaign around it. And I thought brands are certainly B2B brands, but in any brand, it's got multiple dimensions. It's not just a three-word phrase. So that was a fundamental idea of mine that you have to allow a brand to stand for, you know, more than one thing, maybe 6 or 12 things.
Right. Well, and when you say agencies were using this sort of three-word phrase at the time, were those mostly advertising agencies? Was this before the era of the modern brand consultancy for the most part?
Yes. It was advertising agencies because they were running things in those days. And the second thing I really disliked was this fill-in-the-box model. I was an advisor for one of the major global agencies, and they had this fill-in-the-box model that just drove me crazy. They would have 8 boxes, and you had to fill in each one. And, of course, it was really designed around B2C things because that was most of their clients. And if you were a B2B business, there was no box for organizational values.
Right.
And so you didn't have it. And there was a box for brand personality. So even though that wasn't relevant to your brand, had no place in a brand vision, you had to fill in the box. It was borderline tragic. So anyway, those really were the two things. So in my first version of the brand identity model, I didn't even have a brand essence.
Right.
Because I was so, you know, I was so attuned to the fact I didn't want a three-word phrase to appear anywhere. And I later added a brand essence because it turns out for a large percentage of the cases, it's helpful.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not always helpful, but in large percentage of the cases, it is. So I added that. But so the idea is you decide, you sit down and say, what do I want my brand to stand for in customers' minds? And then you make a list, and then you consolidate that list, but you don't have any limit. It can be 3, it can be 6, it can be 9, it can be 12.
Mm-hmm.
And so on. And then after you're done, you prioritize those. You pick out 3 or 4 or 5 that are the most important. They're then at the core.
Right.
And then you pick out the rest are extended identity, which plays a really useful role because they provide extra texture and guidance for something that's not front and center. A lot of the sort of table stakes attributes of your brand are there because they're not going to differentiate, but they need to be there. And so now you have a home for them. And sometimes they can graduate from extended to core. One of the best examples of brand strategy is that of the Berkeley Haas Business School that I've been involved with. And they have these 4, what they call them, defining principles, as mm-hmm. opposed to brand vision or values or anything. They call them defining principles. But one of them is confidence without attitude. I mean, half the student body are there because of that of that principle. I mean, they're so attracted to it because every other major business school in the company is just filled with students that have a bit of arrogance. You know, mm-hmm. they got in and then they don't have to do anything else. And Berkeley Haas is not like that. And that the interesting thing is that was an extended identity element for 3 or 4 years before it graduated into the core. If we didn't have an extended identity, it probably never would have surfaced.
And do you think it graduated the way it did because the school realized how important it was, or was there a fundamental change to either the school or the student body?
No, I think they just realized how differentiating and important it was. In retrospect, it's obvious. I mean, confidence without attitude just blows out at you.
Yeah.
It's a perennial reality and a big problem of all the major name business schools.
Sure.
And it's just not there at Berkeley. You know, their admission process tries to weed out people that have attitudes.
Let's get into the weeds a little bit, if you don't mind, on the brand vision model. You introduced it, like you said, as the brand identity model. You've changed the name of it. It's also known, I guess you probably don't call it this, but a lot of people just refer to it as the Acker model. And you introduced it in 1996. You talked a little bit about the situation at that time and sort of why you felt it was important to create this model. But I really want to understand the brand vision elements that we've been talking about. How do you know when you have something that is going to work well as one of these brand vision elements? Are there any rules of thumb or tests that you can do, stress tests, even mental exercises to say, yeah, that's really going to serve us well, or that's kind of a throwaway that we shouldn't even bother to include?
Yeah, there's sort of three things you're looking for. One is that you want it to differentiate from other brands.
Mm-hmm.
And second of all, you want it to resonate with customers. And you also want it to be something you can deliver.
Right.
And so what you're looking for there is what I call the strategic imperatives or proof points. So it either has to be something you already can deliver and people will accept that you can deliver it, a proof point, or it has to be something, it's aspirational, but you've got a strategic imperative. That means you've got a commitment to do it.
Right.
And you're going to create programs and so forth to do it. So it becomes, if it's not real now, it will become real.
Right. And yet, is it true that not all of the vision elements need to check all three of those boxes? Is it okay for some of them to be less differentiating and it's more about the complete picture? You ensure that with all of them in place, you have something that's differentiating?
Yeah, I think that's certainly true. There's sort of no fine and hard rule. It's kind of a judgment case.
Right.
But usually, and what will happen is if you have three or four different elements, for one audience, you might emphasize one. For another audience, it might emphasize another. And also, you might spin one a little different for one audience than you do with another. So it gives you the ability to be able to use this brand vision in different contexts.
This episode of How Brands Are Built is brought to you by SquadHelp, the world's number one naming platform. Here's how SquadHelp works. You launch a naming contest to engage hundreds of naming experts. You're guided through an agency-level naming process that goes beyond traditional crowdsourcing. The platform uses AI and includes name validation features such as audience testing, trademark validation, linguistic analysis, and quality scoring. And SquadHelp doesn't just do naming. You can also use their platform for taglines or slogans, as well as logo design. To launch your naming contest today, go to squadhelp.com and start receiving custom name suggestions instantly. SquadHelp, company, brand, and business name ideas by experts. Today's episode is also brought to you by Rev.com, offering fast, affordable, accurate audio transcription and captions. I use Rev all the time to transcribe episodes of this podcast, but also for recorded interviews I conduct during brand strategy projects for clients. I've tried a few other services, and I keep coming back to Rev because their transcriptions are some of the most accurate I've seen, their turnaround time is less than 24 hours, and transcriptions cost just $1 a minute. Right now, Rev is offering listeners of this show $10 off your first order. To get that $10 off coupon, visit rev.com/blog/HBAB for How Brands Are Built. Again, that's rev.com/blog/HBAB. Rev. Transcriptions made simple. In the book and elsewhere, I've seen you mention dimensions of brand vision elements. So a dimension might be personality or organizational values. Mm-hmm. Is there a list of potential dimensions that you could explore for any given client?
Yeah, I think there is in building strong brands and also in brand leadership. And that's where I modified the model to include brand essence.
Mm-hmm.
But the lists are mainly sort of why don't you consider this? Why
right.
don't you consider that? It's not a fill in the box model where you have to have one of those in there.
Right. It just ensures that you at least ask yourself the question of
would this
be useful for us?
And that's most helpful in brand personality and organizational values because they're often bypassed.
Other than the brand essence, which you added in later, do those dimensions change over time? I mean, just in your own experience, have you discovered any that you didn't include in earlier books? Or do you feel that some are maybe less important now than they were when you first wrote those books?
No, I don't think so. But I do think that for a lot of reasons, the concept of a higher purpose is more important now than it has been in decades past. And I think for a lot of reasons, you have to inspire your employees, especially millennials. They don't want to work for a company that's just engaged in increasing sales and profits.
Mm-hmm.
You want to have a relationship with customers that go beyond functional benefits. And you want visibility and energy. And sometimes the way to get that is by having a higher purpose. You know, you're just not going to get there with bar soap or foot or whatever you make.
Does that idea of the higher purpose dovetail at all with your signature stories? Did this idea that purpose was becoming increasingly important help motivate you to focus on signature stories?
Well, it is true that in many organizations, if you want to really create strong stories, it's just not going to happen with your product. I mentioned bar soap. Unilever's Lifebuoy brand developed a program in Asia called Help a Child Reach 5 because 2 million kids die that are under the age of 5 every year, mostly from waterborne illnesses that can be mitigated by having better hand washing.
Mm-hmm.
So they had this hand washing program they introduced into, started out in some villages in India. They got some video describing those efforts and the results, focusing on a mother in each case. They got 44 million views.
Wow.
Again, this is bar soap, 44 million views. So the lesson is you need stories, and you're not going to get them from your bar soap attributes,
right?
But you are going to get them from this Help a Child Reach 5. Starbucks, you know, is all about inspiring and nurturing people, one cup, one city, and one person at a time. It's a very ennobling higher purpose. It's not about making great coffee.
Right.
And they developed a program called the Upstanders, where they found 10 stories back in a couple of years ago of people doing, ordinary people doing extraordinary things for positive good. And they had some amazing stories. And they, of course, they have a lot of control over media, but they got 80 million views from those stories. And so that really, A, supports their higher purpose, and B, provides them with visibility and energy and warm, has fuzzy feelings for the brand. And again, that came from a higher purpose. It didn't come from
coffee beans.
You know, how do we communicate the fact we make great coffee?
Right. Well, this is a great segue into your most recent book, Creating Signature Stories. So first question on this is just how do you define that term, signature story?
Well, my daughter taught storytelling at the Stanford Graduate School of Business for 6 or 7 years. And during that time, I got to learn about how powerful stories were. And the challenge was, you know, we tried to figure out what is not a story. Because if you say, what is your brand story, you're going to get 4 bullet points of product attributes.
Yeah.
And so finally, we decided that a story is not facts, program descriptions, or attributes. It's a narrative, a once-upon-a-time narrative. You know, it's involving, it's authentic, it's intriguing. And it has some sort of a wow factor. I mean, it really jumps out at you. It's something you want to share with others because it's so entertaining, so informative, so relevant, or something. And it has a strategic message. So that's what a signature story is. And that kind of laid the foundation, the platform for the book.
Yeah, you mentioned this term brand story that's floating out there. Again, another buzzword. It's very popular right now. But I've noticed also that people really use it to mean totally different things. If you ask about it, sometimes you get what's more of a brand positioning statement. Sometimes you get an ad that tells a great story, but it's really just an ad. It's not so strategic. So it sounds like you are really trying to tease those things apart. And that's, I suppose, why you've come up with this new term, signature story.
Yes. And it was really motivated by my learning that stories are just unbelievably powerful. It's, it's astounding. And there's hundreds and hundreds of studies in the psychology and communication and marketing literature that prove that.
Right.
Really good experimental studies. And it turns out that stories get attention. It turns out that stories persuade, they change perceptions. They do that because they avoid counter-arguing. I mean, it's a story.
Yeah.
Who's going to argue?
Right.
And it works because the audience learns for themselves the message. You're not telling them the message. And it learns because there's a lot of affect in stories. People like the storyteller, they like the plot, they like the result, they like the hero. And that gets transferred to the brand that's associated with a story. It's a common sense, but it's a well-known psychological finding under the label affect transfer. And it can inspire and energize because the story can have emotion. You're not going to get that by communicating facts.
So what's one of your favorite examples of a brand signature story?
Well, one of the best use of signature stories that I've run across, and I've got a lot of them, but one is UC Health. And I encourage anybody to go to their website. That's the University of Colorado Regional Health Organization called UC Health. And if you go to their website, all you see is stories. They don't talk about their facilities, their doctors, their anything else. They talk about patient stories. You know, one of them you can look for is Becky's story. And Becky was celebrating her fifth year anniversary in Breckenridge ski area, and she got a heart attack at lunch, and she was helicoptered to UC Health, and her heart was practically dead on arrival when she got there. And they put her in the room, and you see her, a doctor come in the room, and she, you see her asking the doctor, "Do we have a heart?" And he said, "Yes."
Wow.
And then you see the team of six people transplanting her health. And then you see her afterwards talking about how she's going to go to the mother of the donor and allow her to hear the heart beating of her daughter and learn what it's going to accomplish. I mean, you can't watch these videos without crying. And they have 100 of these videos. And they were named one of the top 10 health care facilities in the nation alongside Johns Hopkins and Cleveland Clinic. And they're just a regional healthcare thing in Colorado.
Yeah.
And it's all about these patient stories. It's really phenomenal.
So that's a great example of a signature story that's about the, well, let's say the customer, although in this case it's a patient. Can a signature story be explicitly about the brand or about the customer, or could it be maybe not so much about either, but just kind of a story about something that the brand cares about? Like what are...
Oh, yeah. You could have a story like Caterpillar might have a huge earth-moving equipment that took down a mountain or something like that. Or mm-hmm. you have a big ship that docked in some port, and the story of that can be fascinating. You can have a founder story. Or take Haier, which is now the largest appliance manufacturer in the world. In the mid-80s, they were a fading little company that was putting out junk in China. And this guy took it over, this middle manager took it over, and the customer came in and said, "I got a defective appliance." And he said, "No problem, we'll go to our stock and pick out one." And they went there and they found that 30% of them were defective. And he put those in the factory floor and they got a sledgehammer and destroyed them all. I mean, that story to this day, everybody at Haier knows it, and most of their dealers know it too. And it sort of symbolizes their commitment to quality that they made at that day. And it's been one of the platforms that have led them to be this leading manufacturer.
I'm sure the book is chock full of tips for making sure that you're writing a strong signature story. But do you have any that you can share, just kind of quick tips to get people started if they're thinking about writing their own signature stories for their brands?
Well, I think that there's four things that got to happen if you want to have a program that works. One, you have to really believe in the power of stories. I mean, you just have to get religion. And you can do that by understanding the evidence, but you can also do it by trying it out and seeing how powerful it is. And second of all, then you have to find strong stories. And it's just any story won't do. It has to be a story that has that wow factor that pops out at you. And the third thing, you've got to figure out a way to get them done so they're really effective. I mean, great presentation won't help a bad story, but a great story can be killed without good presentation. So that means you got to have access to videographers or editors, people that can really put together a story. Now, at UC Health, they have a staff that lives with a patient for 3 days. They really get to know them, become really intimate with them. So when they tell the story, it really works. And they always tell it from the eyes and mouths of the patients themselves.
Right.
And then the fourth is you've got to have media expertise. You have to have a way to distribute the stories. And of course, social media needs to play a role, but you need to distribute the story.
Mm-hmm. Why don't we turn to a few wrap-up questions? You've talked about so many great brands today in all of the examples you've given, but are there any brands out there that you just feel like they're doing everything or almost everything right? So from brand vision to signature stories and everything else that you would recommend, whether it's a big company or a small company or a product brand?
Well, besides UC Health, I think that I'm so impressed with Unilever.
Mm-hmm.
And look at what they've done with not only Lifebuoy, mentioned that, but Dove with the Real Beauty stuff. And they're just so passionate about having a higher purpose and doing things meaningful alongside their business.
Yeah.
And I think that's really, really impressive.
A question that I like to ask authors, given that you've been so prolific, are there any books other than your own that you recommend or that you've read recently and really taken something away from, whether it's a branding or business book or just something else that's kind of informed your thinking about brands and business?
Yeah, well, I really read books and love books, and I wish more people did. But Anyway, there's two elephant books that really have affected me, my thinking over the years. One is a book by George Lakoff, who's a professor at Berkeley. It's Don't Think of an Elephant. And it's just an amazing book because he really gets at the essence of branding and communication. And it's all about framing the discussion. And he talks about why that's important and how you do it and how it works. He uses a lot of examples from the political sphere and how good the Republicans over a long period of time have been at framing the discussion. And once you frame the discussion, you're kind of screwed because if you talk about tax relief, if that's the way it's framed,
right?
Who's against tax relief?
This is like the pro-life versus pro-choice and all of the ways that
semantics
can
impact. Exactly.
Yeah.
And then you have these Democrats that fall into the trap of, you know, they're pro-abortion
right. And
instead of pro-life. And anyway, it's all about framing the discussion. And that's really what branding gets down to. If you can frame the discussion in a certain way that, you know, the teeth brushing is about cleaning your mouth or sanitizing your mouth or something. If you can frame the discussion that way, then that's the way people will come to the decision and come to their use experience as well. So I thought that's really, an important book, George Lakoff. Another elephant book is Who Says a Elephant Can't Dance by Lou Gerstner, who told the story of him taking over IBM, who was basically a failing company that was going to be broken up in the early 90s, and what he did and the problems he faced. And there's such a typical problem, the silo problem. I wrote a book called Spanning Silos. The way he took that on, the way he took the brand issue on, how he found out from customer research what the brand should stand for, and then he made it happen, and how he consolidated all the disparate brand messaging that was going on. It was really a tour de force, and it's a delightful read, and I go back to that a lot.
And just a coincidence that they're both elephant-related, I suppose?
Yes, they both have elephant in the title.
Makes it easy to remember, though. So final question for you. Just given your success and your career as a brand thinker, what advice do you give to young people that are entering the world of brand and marketing, whether they're on the strategy side or the design side or just interested in getting into the field?
Well, I think that companies today, and not only client companies, but consulting companies, are just absolutely terrified about becoming relevant in the digital age. And one of the advantages you have as somebody who's coming out of college or graduate school is that you're young and you understand social media.
Mm-hmm.
So it wouldn't hurt to go in as a social media specialist or as an analytical specialist if you happen to be good at statistics and
right.
and so forth to be a data analyst, because, I mean, they're just desperate for people that can do analytical work, or even if they can interact with people that do analytical work, even if they understand it. So I think that those are two ways to open the door.
That's great advice. David, thank you so much for spending time with me.
My pleasure. Thanks. It was very enjoyable.
Thanks for listening to How Brands Are Built. To learn more about David Acker, visit davidacker.com. That last name is spelled A-A-K-E-R. That URL will redirect you to his blog on the Profit website, where you can also read about his latest books and find links to buy them. Of course, you can also follow David on LinkedIn, where he's an influencer, on Twitter or Medium at David Acker, or honestly, just Google him and you'll find plenty to read. If you found this episode useful or interesting, please go back and listen to the rest of the season on brand positioning. If you listen carefully, you'll hear some themes as well as points where the other experts I've talked to, people like Marty Neumeier and Laura Rees, agree or disagree with some of the ideas shared in the interview you just heard. And if you're interested, check out season 1, 9 interviews with some of the world's leading experts on brand naming, and a wrap-up episode with tips you can incorporate into your next naming project. For more information on How Brands Are Built, you can visit us online at howbrandsarebuilt.com. I'll post a summary of this conversation with useful links, and while you're there, you can check out other articles or episodes about branding. Lastly, if you have a chance, I'd love it if you'd leave a rating and review and subscribe to the show at Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, SoundCloud, or wherever you listen to podcasts. How Brands Are Built is a production of Heirloom Agency, LLC. Our theme music is by Isha Erskine Project. I'm Rob Meyerson, and I'll talk to you next time.